Students and welcome in the online session of class 9 science. Today we are starting a new lesson, that is chapter number 9, forces and laws of motion. Now the learning targets for this video session are force and the effects of force, balanced and unbalanced force, and Galileo's observation and Newton's first law of motion. So let's start with the first topic, that is force and the effects of force. Now let us first discuss that what is a force. So you can say that force is the effort to pull or push an object. Fine, this is the simplest definition of force, that force is nothing but a push or pull applied on an object. If the force is applied away from the body, then it is called push. If the force is applied towards the body, then it is called a pull. So, in both the cases, the pull and the push are called the forces. Now, let us see the effects of force. Effects of force means what a force can do. Now, the first effect of force is that force can change the size and shape of the body. Now, here you can see that a spring is shown. So, by applying the force, its size and its shape can be changed. So the force can change the size and shape of the body. Like if you are hammering, suppose there is a metal, and if you are hammering it, then its shape will be changed. If suppose there is a dough and you are applying force on the dough, then its shape and size will also change. So the first thing we have to remember that a force can change the size and shape of the body. Now next is, force can change the direction of the moving body. If suppose a body is in motion, then its direction can be changed only by applying the force. Suppose you are driving a bicycle and you want to change the direction, right? So you have to apply the force by your hands to move the handle in another direction. And you have to apply some brakes, or you have to suppose accelerate, then also force is needed. So force can change the direction of the moving body. Now the third one is that force may change the speed of the body. Now if a body is moving with a less speed, then its speed can be increased by applying the force. Or if a body is moving with a very high speed and we want to reduce it, then that is also possible by applying the force. Now suppose you are driving a car and you want to increase the speed of the car, then in that case we have to accelerate. So we are applying the muscular force of the legs on the accelerator. If you are driving a scooter or a bicycle or a motorcycle, then you can accelerate with your hands. Okay, muscles of your hands will function here. So the force is applied by the hands or the legs to change the speed of the body. Now suppose there is a ball, and if you want to increase the speed of the ball, suppose the ball is rolling on the ground and you want to increase the speed. So you have to give a kick to the ball so that its speed can be increased. Okay, so force can change the speed of the body. Now the next is, force may change moving body into rest. Fine, if suppose a body is moving and we want that body to come to a rest position, then also force has to be applied. Now suppose the ball is coming in that direction, ball is moving. Now I want to stop it, so I have to catch the ball. So catching is what, that I am applying force by my hands so that the ball can be stopped. And once the ball is stopped, that means the moving body has come to rest position. So moving body can come to rest only by applying the force. The last effect of the force is that a force can change the body in rest to state of motion, right? So force can change both ways. A moving body can be brought to rest, and a body in rest can be start to motion only by applying the force. Suppose a car is standing, and if when you start it, when you apply force on it, then only the car starts moving. Suppose you are standing and you want to walk now. So you have to apply muscular force by your legs on the ground so that you can walk. So force can change the body in rest to the state of motion. So these are the effects of forces. That means what a force can do. Now let's move on to the next slide and see what are balanced and unbalanced forces. Okay. we have studied in the lower classes also that there are different types of forces. So here we have to study about balanced and unbalanced forces. Now, if the resultant of all the force acting on the body is zero, then the forces are called the balanced force. Fine. Suppose on a body, many of the forces are acting. Now here you can see that this is a box on which 5 Newton force is applied in this direction and 5 Newton force is applied in opposite direction. So that means 2 of the forces are acting on this box. Now if we see that the resultant force, resultant means that when the forces are acting in opposite direction, then net force will be found by subtracting the forces. If the forces are applied in the same direction, then the forces are added. This you have studied in 8th standard also, right? Like when the forces are applied in opposite direction, then to find the net force, we have to do the subtraction. So here in this case, what will be the net force now? 5 Newton minus 5 Newton, right? So it becomes 0. So net force is 0 in this case. So that means here the force is balanced. So this force acting on the box is now called the balanced force because the net force has become 0. So according to the definition, if the resultant force acting on the body is 0, then in that case the forces are called the balanced forces. Now, under the action of balanced force, body at rest will continue to be at rest, right? So here you can see that the box will neither move in this direction nor it will move in the opposite direction. Nowhere it will move because the forces are balancing. Forces on both the directions are balancing each other. So this box will not move. The box will remain at rest position. Similarly, a body moving uniformly along a straight line will continue to be in the same straight line in same speed when balanced force are applied on the body. Okay, suppose a car is moving and the forces acting on this car are balanced. Okay, so what will happen that this car will continue moving with the same speed in the same direction. So this force acting means balanced force can act on the rest. If the body is in rest and balanced forces are acting, then the body will continue to be in rest position. If the body is moving and the forces acting on that moving body are balanced forces, then the body will continue moving with the same speed. Okay? So this is the effect of the balanced force. And how to find that the force applied is balanced or not? When you find the net force, if it comes to zero, that means the force acting on the body is a balanced force. Right now, here in this diagram also, you can see that 1600 Newton force is applied on this object in right direction and 1600 Newton applied on the left direction. So here you can see that if you find net force, then 1600 minus 1600, it comes to 0 Newton. So this object will not move anywhere. In any of the direction, it will not move. It will stay at its own position. It will remain continue at rest position only. So the forces, both the forces acting on this object, they are called the balanced forces. So they cancel each other's effect. Okay. Now here also in this diagram, you can see that 200 Newton forces are kept on the weighing machine. So what is happening? See, on neither on the sides the weighing machine is going downside. It is balanced here because both the forces are balancing each other here. So they are balanced forces. Okay. Now the next one is example based on balanced force. Let us see one numerical which is based on balanced force. Now there is a game of tug of war. You can see here in the diagram that the team is playing the game of tug of war, in which two teams are just pulling the rope towards themselves. This team is trying to pull the rope towards this side and this team is trying to pull the rope towards this side. So each team has three players. Now the first team applies 60 Newton force. Suppose this is first team and it applied 60 Newton force on the rope. Now this is team number 2. This also applies 60 Newton force, right? So now what happened, children, that 60 Newton force is applied in left direction as well as 60 Newton force is applied on the right direction on the rope. So what type of force is this? Fine. So now you have to tell whether it's a balanced force or an unbalanced force. So in that case, firstly, you have to find the net force. Now you can see that the forces are applied in opposite direction. So whenever the forces are applied in opposite direction, we have to subtract to find the net force. So here you can see that team 1 is applying 60 Newton force and team B is also applying 60 Newton force. So net force will be 60 minus 60, 0 Newtons. Fine. And whenever the net force comes to 0, that means the force is balanced force. Fine. I think with the example, it is more clear to you. Okay. Now let's move on to the next topic, that is unbalanced force. Okay. Now if the resultant of all the forces acting on the body is not 0, that means many of the forces are acting on the body, and if you find the net force, if it does not come to 0, that means the force is unbalanced force. Means all those forces which are acting, they are unbalanced forces. Fine. Now here you can see again there is a tug of war game picture shown here. Now again two teams are there, but what is the difference? That the first team is applying 400 Newton force and the second team is applying 300 Newton force. So you can see here when you find the net force, it comes to 400 minus 300, that means 100 Newton. So it is not 0. Okay. So 100 Newton is the net force. And in which direction this force is acting? It is acting in left direction because here the force applied is more. So naturally, this team will win because this team is applying more force. So net force acting on the rope is 100 Newton and it's an unbalanced force. These forces are unbalanced. They are not balancing each other. Fine. Now here you can see in the second picture, first boy is applying 75 Newton force on the ball and the other boy is applying 125 Newton force. So now you can guess easily that in which direction the ball will move. Whether the ball will move in right direction or whether the ball will move in left direction, right? So, the one who is applying more force will be able to shift the ball towards the left side. So, here 125 Newton force is more than 75 Newton. So, naturally the second boy will win and the ball will move in the direction this boy wants to move it. So, the ball will move in this direction, right? So, these are unbalanced forces. Now, let us see one example based on it. Now, while playing volleyball of single players, for hitting the ball, one applies force of 400 Newton and the other player applies the force of 380 Newtons. Fine. So, this is player 1. So, this player is applying 400 Newton force to the ball. And this is player 2. So, this player is applying 380 Newton force on it. So, both the forces are applied on the ball. So, let's find out what is the net force acting on the ball. So, now it is in opposite direction, so we will subtract it, right? Because this is applying the force in this direction, second pair is applying in this direction. So, we will subtract it and you will find that the net force is 20 Newtons. So, it is not 0. Fine. If the net force is not 0, that means the force is an unbalanced force. Okay? And in which direction this will be applied? Because this first player is applying more force, so ball will be shifted towards this direction. Okay, now the next is Galileo's observation. Before starting Newton's laws of motion, Galileo was one of the scientists who also observed some very important things related to motion. So let us see what he observed. So Galileo observed, when a small marble ball rolled down an ideal frictionless plane inclined from both the sides, then... Okay, so what is the case here? That there is a marble ball which is rolling downside on an inclined plane. This is the inclined plane, slide. So the ball is rolling down here in this direction. Fine, this is the height h on which the body is kept. The ball was there on height h and from there the ball is released on an inclined plane. Now, you can see in the diagram here that after coming to the ground, there are three possible ways here shown according to Galileo's observation that how the ball will move, right? So, when the ball comes down, so velocity, now when the ball is moving, so what is happening? The gravity force is acting on it as it is moving towards the earth, towards the ground. So, gravity force will work on it. So, velocity of the ball goes on increasing due to the unbalanced force of gravity. Fine. So what will happen as the ball will roll down and down, so gravity will increase on it. and other forces will reduce. Okay, so the force become unbalanced and the velocity of the ball goes on increasing, means ball will come down with more speed. Okay, now the ball climbs the inclined plane on right, the velocity of the ball goes decreasing due to unbalanced force of opposing gravity. Now once the ball reach here, it will not stop. So once it comes here and there are other inclined planes on the right hand side, you can see here there are three different planes drawn here. This is S1. Okay, this is first plane, this is second inclined plane and third inclined plane. Fine. So this is left side inclined plane and these three are the right side inclined planes. Okay, so the ball will move onto these inclined planes like this in three different ways. So now the body moves on these inclined planes, then what is the velocity of the ball? So that was the observation of Galileo. So when the inclination of O1 on right side is same as O, okay, you can see here written O1, means O1 is the first inclined plane, right? This one, first one. O2 is this middle one and O3 is this third one. These are the inclined planes. So when the inclination of O1 on right side is same as O on the left side, you can see here that O1, this angle, that means this angle, right? So if this angle is equal to this O angle on the left hand side, if they are same, then the distance covered before stopping is same. That means then the distance covered, you can see here that the distance covered is the same here by the ball, right? Means if the angle of inclination is the same on both the sides, okay, if the angle of inclination, these are the angle of inclinations, right? From here the ball was coming and this is the ground. So this angle, if it is same, right, in case of O1, okay, so the distance traveled is the same, means this much distance, and if this distance you will travel, this will be the same. Fine, means this distance traveled will be equal to this distance traveled in first case. Now you can see that this O2 is this angle. Now inclination is going to reduce one by one. Okay, here in the first case we have seen that O1 was equal to O. These both angles were same. But now what is happening? In the second case, O2 angle is less than O1. Okay, now we are reducing the angle. Fine. So what he observed, that when the angle of inclination of right side plane is reduced, means we have now reduced the angle of inclination of O2, distance covered by ball before stopping increases. So what happens when you reduce the inclination, then what happens? The distance covered increases. Now here you can see that the first case distance covered was S1. In the second case the distance covered is S2. So in first case distance covered was up to here, but in second case it has raised a little bit up to S2. Okay, so this distance is more, you can see easily, this distance is more than this distance. Fine. So if the angle of inclination is reduced, okay, then the distance covered increases. Okay, why it is so? Because in first case you can see that more the height, then the gravity reduces. Gravity is reducing, okay, opposing gravity reduces, and in this case the gravity is a little bit increased than the first case. Okay, so distance traveled increases. Now again in the third case you can see that O3, the third inclination angle, is more less than the O2 also. O1, this angle was the highest one, then less is O2, and O3 is much less than O2 also. So we are reducing the inclination angle. Fine. And as we are reducing the inclination angle, the distance traveled by the ball on the right hand side is increasing. You can see S1 is the smallest distance, S2 is little more, and S3 distance traveled is much more than both of these. Okay. So when the right side plane were made horizontal, so we are seeing that as the inclination angle is goes on decreasing, the distance traveled by the ball is increasing. Now if we keep the inclination zero, that means if we have chosen now this surface, so what will happen? That the ball would have gone much more at much more distance than these three cases. Fine. So this is the these were the observations of Galileo. Okay, that if the inclination angle is reduced, the distance traveled by the ball on these right hand side inclinations, they goes on increasing. Distance traveled goes on increasing by decreasing the angle of inclination. Okay, as such, this Galileo observation does not come in exam, but just for your knowledge, you have to just, you know, keep in your mind that what were Galileo's observation. So they were related to gravity and the distance traveled by the ball on inclination. Fine. Now let's move on to the Newton's first law of motion. Now these are very important topics. Okay, laws of motion. So there are three different laws of motion which you have to study. So three laws of motion are there, and they are based on the ideas of Galileo's observation, right? What observation we have studied now, on the basis of that, Newton has given three laws of motion. So these laws, as they were given by Newton, so they are called Newton's laws of motion. Now let us start with the first law of motion, that is, it is called first law of motion only. So according to the Newton's first law, it states that a body at rest will continue to be at rest or in uniform motion along a straight line until and unless any external force is applied on it. Okay, so what is the meaning of the first law? You have to remember these lines given in the first law of motion, that any body which is at rest will continue to be at rest only. Any body which is in uniform motion on a straight line will continue to be in the uniform motion only unless and until any external force is applied on it. Fine. Till we do not apply any external force, we cannot change the state of the body. If the body is in rest, it will be in rest only till any external force is applied. If the body is moving in uniform motion in a straight line, then it will continue to move in a straight line until we apply any external force on it. Okay, so this is Newton's first law of motion. So a body at rest will continue to be at rest unless external force is applied. Fine. So for example, a book, it is lying on the table. Until we did not apply any force, so book will remain on the table on its own position until we apply some force on it. Fine. Then second case, what was uniform motion? A body in uniform motion continues to move uniformly until external force is applied. Motion of every body is being opposed by invisible forces like air resistance or friction. So if these opposing forces are removed, the statement would be true. Fine. Means when the body is moving, then other forces are also acting on it, like air force, okay, friction with the air. These are some of the forces which are acting on it. But still we can say that in case of uniform motion, the body continues to be in uniform motion until we apply some external force. Now a body moving along a straight line will continue to move in straight line unless external force is applied. Okay, like suppose the bike is moving in a particular direction, in a straight direction. Until we do not apply any brake, until we do not move the handle, then the bike will continue to be moving in that speed only. Okay, so this is Newton's first law of motion. Let us try to understand it with some of the diagrams. So here you can see a ball is shown here. So this is an object for us. So an object at rest will remain at rest until any force applies on this ball. It will remain at its own position. It will not move by its own. Fine. So now in the second case, you can see that the some person is trying to kick the ball. Okay. So now kicking the ball is the external force which is applied on the ball. Now this external force can change the state of the ball. Previously, the ball was in rest state. Now once the ball is kicked, it will start moving, so it will be in motion. So now you can see that the ball is kicked and now the ball is moving, it is in motion, and it will continue with the constant speed and direction unless friction is applied on it. Fine. Friction stops the motion. Then you can see here that the ball strikes the net, and here this net is applying the external force due to which the ball will stop. So unless an external force is not applied, the object, if it is in rest, continues at rest. If it is in motion, it continues in motion. Friction can stop, because friction is also a force which can stop the moving object. Okay, if the ball is rolling on the ground, after some time it will stop because of the frictional force. So that frictional force is also an external force which can stop the movement of the ball. Now next is inertia and mass. Okay, these are the concepts which are hidden in the first law of motion. These are the reasons for the first law of motion. So according to the first law, a body continues, cannot move until some external force is applied on it. Or we can say that all the objects resist a change in their state. This is the important word here, right? That all the objects, they resist the change. Suppose I am sitting. So my body will resist the change. I want to now start walking. I want to walk now. But my body will resist this change. Okay, resist means it will oppose. The body will oppose that change. And that opposition, that resistance is due to inertia. Okay, it is due to inertia. Okay, so all the body, as we have studied in the first law, that a body continues to be at rest until an external force is applied. This is because that the body of the object resists the change in the state. Okay, and that is termed as inertia. So what we can say that inertia of a body, every body has its own inertia. So inertia of a body is the inability of the body to change by itself. Okay, so inertia of the body is the resistance of the body towards the change in the state. Okay, it is the inability of the body to accept the change in the state. Fine. So you have to learn the definition of inertia. The first law of motion defines inertia and is rightly called the law of inertia, right? So first law of motion can also be called as the law of inertia. And you'll be means you have to keep in mind that larger the force required to change the state of body, greater the inertia. Okay, if you have to apply more force to the body so that the body starts moving, so more the force applied, this clearly tells that more is the inertia. Fine. And the mass of the body is the measure of the inertia. When the inertia will be more, when the mass of the body is more. Suppose you have two bodies, right? Here you can see that there are two bodies. So this body is of 10 kg weight and this body is of 0.2 kg weight. So means the first body has more weight. More the mass of the body, more the weight of the body, that means it has more inertia. More inertia, that means it will resist the change of rest more. So more force has to be applied to this body to make it move. Okay, so if there is a ball of 10 kg and if there is a ball of 0.2 kg, so you have to apply more force on 10 kg ball so that it can move. Because its inertia is more. Its mass is more, so its inertia is more. Its inertia is more, then you have to apply more force on it. Fine. So what is inertia finally? Inertia is the resistance of the body to oppose the change in the state of rest or of motion. Okay. So let us see some very beautiful examples of inertia. That inertia is of three types. Inertia of rest, inertia of motion and inertia of direction. Fine. So let us see what is inertia of rest. That means inability of the body to change by itself. Like if a body is in rest position, then the body does not want to come in motion. Body will resist that change and that is called the inertia of rest. Fine. Suppose, see, if you are sitting in a bus and suddenly the bus starts, right? When the bus starts moving, so you get a jerk. Your body gets a jerk. Okay. Towards which side you get the jerk, right? You get a jerk on the back side. Fine. Why you are getting it on backside? Because now see, when you are sitting inside, the bus has started moving. But you are still sitting inside the bus. You are not moving. You are just sitting. So your body does not want that change. So your body will resist that change. And that's why car or the vehicle will move ahead, but you are there. So you will get a jerk on the backside. And then after some time, you will get straight. Fine, you will get a jerk and then you will come to the straight position. So that backside jerk you have got because of the inertia of rest. Because your body does not want to move. Okay, so you were at rest position, so your body resists that change. So you are there only and the car started moving. So your body gets a backward jerk. Okay, and suppose you are moving. Okay, so suppose this is inertia of motion. Now you are moving in a bus and suddenly the bus stops. The bus applies the brakes. Then what happens? You get again your body gets a jerk, but not backside. Now this time you will get a jerk in the forward side because bus was moving, but suddenly the bus stops. Your body was also now in motion with the bus. Now suddenly the bus stops, but your body does not. Your body does not want to come to rest position now. So body will resist the change. So you will get a forward jerk now this time. Okay, so these are the examples of inertia of motion and inertia of rest. Fine, I think it is clear. And then third is the inertia of direction. So inertia of direction means inability of the body to change the direction by itself. No body can change the direction by itself. Okay. So the body, because again, what is the reason? That body resists that change. Body does not want to change it. Okay. So for that, we have to apply some force. That is the inertia of direction. For example, vehicle passing through mud, rotating wheels of vehicle throughout mud tangentially due to directional inertia. Okay, if the body has kept in the mud, so what is happening, that the tire is moving, rotating on the same place. Okay, because the body resisting the change, so more force has to be applied so that the body can overcome this inertia and the direction can be changed. So there are three types of inertia we have studied: inertia of rest, inertia of motion, and inertia of direction. Inertia, again I am saying that this is the inability of the body or the resistance of the body towards the change in the state. Fine, if the body is in rest, body does not want to be in motion, so it will resist. If the body is in motion, then it will resist the change for rest position. Okay. So here we complete with today's session. So we have seen today what is a force, what are the effects of force, then Galileo's observation with the marble ball, and then Newton's first law of motion, which is also called the law of inertia. I guess the topics are clear to you. If not, you just read the lesson, and when we'll do the revision on the Google Meet, that time more will be clear to you. Okay. So read the lesson thoroughly, and we'll meet in the next session. Till then, all of you stay home and stay safe.